Welcome to Night Shadows. I'm Stuart Best. Where the paranormal is normal. Where that which you thought you knew, you didn't. And where the future can be known, if you know exactly where to look.
Well, hello everybody, Stuart Best here, and we hope to get Richard Shaw on board. We got Larry. Larry, are you there?
Yes, sir. Thanks for having me.
Okay, I'm going to see if this is a number. Hello, is this Richard? No, I guess not. I can't hear anything there, Larry.
No, it sounds like a news channel talking. That's not probably going to be him. You might have to call him on his 818 number.
Okay, wait just a minute. Wait just a second. I'll try and reach him that way. Sorry for the glitches here. Let's see. So it's 1-8-1.
Well, a lot of things goes on these days, Stuart. It's hard to find them out.
I know. Yeah, there's so many glitches because of solar activity and whatnot. Let's see if he answers.
Hello?
Can you hear me now?
Yeah. Is this Richard?
I've been online using Skype and could hear you guys just fine, and you couldn't hear me.
No, I couldn't hear you at all. Okay.
That's very weird.
Glad you're on board now.
No, it's funny. Blog Talk did a strange thing to me this time. According to your email, you sent me to call you a few minutes in advance, which I did. And it's, you know, I got the typical Blog Talk Radio, 3 minutes to air, goodbye, and then hung up on me.
Well, we're learning the system as we go, I think.
Yeah.
Anyway.
Really funny. Thank you, Stuart, for having me on again. Larry, it's good to hear your voice.
Thank you.
Yeah, well, I appreciate you coming on. Where do we want to start? Let's start with maybe your watchers. Now, when are you releasing that?
Looks like it's going to be sometime in July. I don't know exactly when because we still have 3 interviews that we're shooting.
Okay.
And these things kind of came up unexpectedly. People were showing up in town that we really wanted to have in the film. And, you know, we can't afford to fly everybody in, but this was like a real windfall. So we thought we would postpone until we had these other interviews, some of them which we're recording next week. But a lot of it has already been filmed. It's these projects take literally months to put together. No one really understands that, but there's a lot of work goes into a single watcher.
Yeah.
It usually takes 6 months to a year to produce one.
I don't think people realize how much time it takes to make a documentary, to write a book. You know, they see the final product, but they don't think about how much work went into it. And
they're inundated with stuff.
Yes, yes. And I think they also, you know, this is probably where this intellectual rights battle starts in, because they don't appreciate how much work went into a product. And all they have is the little thing in their hand, a DVD or a book, and something happens in the mind where they think they have the right to just steal it and do what they want with it. And it's growing worse, I guess, over time. But anyway, what can you tell us about Watchers 10?
What
do you want to release? Let's put it that way.
Well, I just sent you guys a note, and thank you, Stuart, also for sending me your excellent DVD with all of your references to the coming years here. I mean, it is something that a lot of us are looking at, including Tom Horn. I had a long discussion with him about it when I was on Skywatch back in March, and he wrote that book called Zenith 2016, and we just kind of looked at each other and just go, we just want to know why there's so many things pointing to this particular year, this year and next. And of course, Rabbi Glazerson's constantly finding stuff in the Torah codes about it, and we just don't know what all that means, but we feel like we just have to continuously explore it. Since it's happening, there has to be some reason for it. So anyway, thank you for the DVD, and I have a DVD player in my car, so even when I was pressed for time, I could pop your disc in and listen to it while I'm driving down the road.
Well, it's amazing.
And, you know, there's a lot of great information in there, and it looked like you were researching 2012 a couple years before 2012 happened, which is kind of what we were going through as well, trying to figure it out.
Yeah, it's kind of difficult how you merge it, but I know Tom Horn has gone back and kind of revisited it, and you know, it may be right. You know, that's the thing. That's the funny thing, is that you really don't know. And then we've got this thing in the scriptures over and over about delay, that there will be a delay. In fact, if you go into the Dead Sea Scrolls, it mentions that the delay would be much greater than even the prophets themselves thought. So
yeah, I mean, we see the basically the crumbling of societarial, I guess you would call it, norms all around the world. And this can't go on much longer without something massive happening. And I just read an article on WND a few minutes ago, and it was just amazing that Ambassador Mull didn't know what BDS was. And he's the guy that's writing these letters in favor of Iran. And, of course, BDS is the Boycott, Divestment, and Sanctions Movement against Israel and against Israeli products. And it's just, this is just, it's like Bernie Sanders not knowing who Michael Oren was, and yet making all these comments about Israel. Completely unfounded comments and completely untrue. You know, it's just like, well, okay, great.
Well, of course.
Ignorance, you know?
Well, Israel, we had Dan Gordon on, and it was kind of interesting because it just seems to me that no matter what Israel does or does not do, they're blamed totally for it. And, you know, anything that works.
We spent all day with Dan Gordon 2 days ago.
You did?
And, yeah, he was actually in L.A., and I said, would like to get you on the show. And so he drove up the mountain, and we had lunch together, and we filmed him doing two interviews. And one of them was about the Egypt Air debacle, because he went to Paris, I guess he was there a week, 10 days ago, and said that they didn't even ask him for his passport when he was at Charles de Gaulle Airport, which is really incredible to me. They don't have really enough security to even guard their own embassies there. Dan said, you know, one RPG could take out the whole setup, and then that'd be, you know, overrun.
Wow.
Very strange, but what he was saying is that plane landed in more than one country before it ended up in Paris, and only was on the tarmac in Paris for an hour. So there wasn't time to search the plane for any kind of bomb or ordnance on it before it took off for Cairo. So that whatever blew the plane up could have been put on the plane in a number of places long before it reached Paris, you know, and set to go. And something like this happened before, he pointed out, in 1994 on a Philippine Airlines flight, where a bomb was mixed and put into a bathroom and killed a man in the bathroom, blew a hole in the side of the plane. The plane, it was able to land, but the bomb did go off by a timer and did what it was supposed to do, and no one took credit for it, just like this one. No one's taking credit. And later they discovered that, I don't know, they had 10 or 12 more planes they were planning on taking down. That's why they didn't want to say who was involved, so the authorities could get on the trail and find out what the whole scheme was. And the only way that they found it was serendipity, because one of the bomb makers had the bomb explode as he was building it. And when they went in to investigate the explosion, they found this computer with all sorts of plans on it on which planes were going to get taken down. It was just a freak accident that allowed the authorities to figure it out and squelch the plan. But in this case, nothing like that has happened yet.
Do they know actually the cause totally yet, or are they still just investigating? I've heard different scenarios of this Egyptian thing. What was your latest?
If they had timed it, they knew the depth of the water in the Mediterranean Sea at the particular point where the plane went down is at one of the deepest places. And for them to find the black box in that deep of water is going to be difficult. They seem to say that they think they're going to find it.
Mm-hmm.
And I guess black boxes are, what, good for 30 days underwater?
Yeah, about
still
that.
Emitting
yep.
a signal. So, you know, hopefully they'll find that, and that will give them some clues on what happened. If it was some kind of malfunction on the plane that took the plane down, or if it was an act of terrorism, I'm pretty much thinking it's terrorism.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, A320s have been flying for decades.
Yeah, they're safer.
They don't crash like that. Yeah. So anyway, that's not a part of Watchers Ken, but I thought that was an interesting discussion that we had with Dan.
Yeah. Well, of course, Israel's in a lot of trouble. Larry, what's your update on anything going on over there that we should know about?
Well, I'll tell you, and I'm sure Richard's keeping up with a little of this, there's been an unprecedented shuffling in the government there, Netanyahu's government. Yalon resigned, and this is what's interesting, and it's really unprecedented. Netanyahu has accepted Lieberman as the new defense minister for Israel. Now, this is shocking because, and the reason this is so shocking is that the so-called Zionist movement or the Israeli elite or any terms you New World Order leading Israel or any of that, those groups that pretty much have run the government for years, a lot of them are shocked because Lieberman, the new defense minister, is a Russian immigrant. And this has really shaken Israel up. Now, of course, you know, in America, we're so busy with Trump and his march forward as the Cyrus, the Persian king in America, we're not keeping up with a lot that's happening, but there's been a really, really bit of intrigue within the, and I'm sure Dan Garden knows all about these people, and he knows these players. I saw Dan on Fox, on Judge Jeanine's Fox program the other day, and it looked like he was being interviewed in Europe. And it was very, very interesting, but I'm sure Dan is keeping touch with all this too, but there's political intrigue playing out in Israel that we're not aware of and we're not watching, but have at the same time, there has never, ever been more and greater danger surrounding Israel than it is now, with the ISIS forces continually pushing, you know, in the Sinai, ISIS forces continually working and fomenting almost a coup in Jordan, which is really one of the strongest, you know, King Abdullah there, you know, on the border of Israel. But at the same time, they're saying behind the scenes that Iran and Hezbollah are plotting some major attacks on Israel, and these are going to be using, and according to Dan's book, and I've read Dan's book, and it's powerful, and Dan's got a mind to fight terrorists like a steel trap. And I guarantee you, his book is incredible. The ending is powerful. But without any more about that, it appears, though, they're going to try to use the tunnel system originally developed by Hamas and use ISIS and an Iranian back and Hezbollah attacks, you know, into Israel by tunnels. And so, you know, I know, Richard, you're keeping up with a lot of this stuff. But of course, I know you're busy, too. But were you aware of this Lieberman? And actually, I see it as a plus for Netanyahu because a lot of his government's been struggling to almost toss him away at this point in time. But Lieberman is a Russian immigrant, and with Russia involved around the world like they are right now, this is a shocker.
Well, I mean, I don't know so much about that particular political situation. I know that Netanyahu has been working quite well with Vladimir Putin in going in and taking out Hezbollah's armaments.
Mm-hmm.
And he doesn't seem to care if Israel wants to fly over there and, you know, and bomb munitions and all of that. I think that's good that they have that kind of relationship. I mean, Putin at times seems more logical in his decisions than Obama does, which is really weird. It's like reality has inverted.
Mm.
But regarding the tunnels, I know that they've been taking them out as fast as they can, and I've known for months that Israel's had some sort of technology to go in and get rid of the tunnels. So apparently they're using that to destroy the tunnels that are there, collapsing them or whatever they do. And I'm sure it's no small undertaking because some of those tunnels are several kilometers long and they're hardened and have railroad tracks in them and they're concrete lined and all of that. So some of them have air conditioning and internet and everything else down there. They spent billions on the tunnel system there.
Yeah.
And
it
hasn't really,
yeah, go ahead.
Hasn't really done any. They haven't been successful in using the tunnels at all, even though they spent that much money on it.
It's got to cost a fortune. But we have, Larry, have you heard any more on the tunnels that are coming into the United States? I mean, we have the same problem, don't we?
Well, absolutely. Yeah, absolutely. And in Dan Gordon's book, he clearly shows how that you know, the ISIS connections and the terror connections that developed between, well, you could say Hamas and ISIS and a lot of the groups actually have connections in South America, and how some of the plans appear to be that come up from South America into Mexico and then use the drug tunnels, which are absolutely extensive. You know, we've seen, I think, a number of them. I believe the DEA and some of the other agencies have found or located some of those tunnels, you know, and they've even got, I guess you could call them, like they used to have in coal mines and such, you know, small train-like systems of cars to haul stuff and people and who knows what, you know, drugs. Those tunnel systems are long that go from Mexico up under a number of locations in Texas and also in California and I guess Arizona probably and those regions. And they're extensive. They're very well built. You know, of course, they've got, you know, plenty of money to do that. And so, according to Dan Gordon's book, you know, the connection is, you know, the terrorists don't have to build the tunnels. They just go in and, you know, pay a few million and rent it, tunnel for nothing.
Right.
So
Dan told us that – sorry, Larry.
Oh, that's okay.
Dan told us that he met with some of the authorities at the border, the U.S. authorities, border patrol, and who let him into some of those tunnels to show him what they're like. He said there's some that are like typical drug smuggling tunnels, and others that were more elaborate, like Hamas tunnels.
Mm-hmm.
And so the drug smuggling tunnels are, you have to crouch over a little bit to walk through them. They're not all that fancy. Whereas the other tunnels are, you know, are concrete and much more elaborate. And apparently we have those now.
So,
and really that's what's so scary now too, is the fact that those tunnels is literally already exist, and they penetrate into the U.S., and we have for the last, this began really in the Bush years, and then went on to Obama, almost 8 years of Obama now, of literally non-observation of borders. Or, you know, even when, Texas called up the Guard to help on the borders, nobody in the federal government didn't care. I mean, they just haven't even bothered. I lacked in Dan Gordon's book, and I don't want to tell a lot about it because people really need to read it. They'll get a kick out of it. They'll really get a kick out of our disorganized government that we have at the present time. But and that POTUS in Dan's book is really, really good. But the interesting thing is, is the fact that, we have, you could almost say we have no borders. We just simply don't have borders anymore, and and we're just wide open. As a matter of fact, guys, I guess POTUS is in Japan today, celebrating Memorial Day. However, upside down as we are, it's so interesting that as Dan Gordon's book said in that book, the POTUS there also. He was letting it happen. He just simply was going to let it happen, and we're almost to another Pearl Harbor, if anybody wants to think that way, which they don't. But we are very,
well,
very vulnerable.
What Dan was saying when we saw him was that in Israel, where they know they have the tunnels and the situation with Hamas, the tunnel area and the border is being completely monitored. They have basically dirigibles with cameras in them. They have drones with cameras in them. I'm sure they're monitoring it on satellite as well, and other devices I'm sure that they're using to detect intrusions across the border. But then they can respond within seconds if they detect something, or if something's set off, or if a rocket is fired, or soldiers are seen coming up in a tunnel, like in the Torah Code film where we show that. So they're ready. Israel's ready to take down anything. They have the IDF, which is highly sophisticated, and those guys really know what they're doing. And here in the States, in San Diego, where it'd be the most likely place to have an incursion to create terror, we're completely unprotected. I mean, we've got a small SEAL team. There's probably less than 1,000 SEALs in the whole country, scattered, all over the place. And we're not protected like Israel is. We're not monitoring the border in the same fashion that Israel is. If these guys popped up and started shooting RPGs into shopping malls in San Diego, it would be complete mayhem. There'd be no one to stop them. And
well,
that's where we're at. I think that's why there's so many people buying guns right now. Because the same people realize that we're right on the edge of something like that happening.
Say, have you heard any more from the good rabbis over there on anything, update on Bible codes concerning any of this?
Nothing on this exactly. One thing that I thought has been interesting, and this isn't Watchers 10 yet, but this is interesting stuff anyway. You guys, I'm sure, all know who Stephen Bassett is. He is the D.C. lobbyist for the UFO disclosure movement. And Stephen has to be, he he's a friend of mine and writes me often with what he's doing, and I write him back with suggestions or whatever. And we've had him in Watchers. We interviewed him in Watchers 7. And he's been working on this thing for years. He's slept out of cars. He's done everything he can to push this forward. And he was really excited when Hillary Clinton was saying she would, if she was elected, that she would try to get this disclosure movement moving. So he got all excited about that.
Mm-hmm.
But lately he released an article that said that he believed that Obama would disclose the UFO phenomena before he leaves office.
Mm.
That he would end up being the disclosure president. Now, if he should do that, if suddenly people are no longer ridiculed about this, but we're looking at it as an actual event, this will change the world as we know it.
Mm-hmm.
Now, I don't know what will happen as a result, but it may be that instead of flying around cloaked all the time, they will openly be in our skies. That could be one thing that we might see. And over a period of time, it might be that we have what people would consider extraterrestrial life walking around on the streets with us. I mean, I don't know. I don't want to rule anything out, as crazy as it sounds, but this stuff isn't science fiction anymore. This is reality, and we're supposed to watch the skies, and that's where all this is happening. And people all over the world are filming these things. And it's not just fuzzy shadows anymore. Some of this stuff is recorded on high-definition broadcast cameras. Some people are using telescopes and shooting it. Now we've got some really great footage, in some cases, really sharp, clear images of what's going on, and it's happening in every major city of the world. We're going to have to do another Watchers update on what's happening with the UFO experience, because it's incredible. I mean, in Watchers 10, we're uncovering so much stuff that I'll be glad. I mean, I'm just exhausted from working on it. I'll be glad when it's done. I mean, I sent a note to you guys today. You're welcome to embed the trailer on your website or whatever you want to do. I just want people to know about it. But essentially, it's the culmination of about 3 years of research that LA has done and that I've participated in. I mean, we both work on these things together. If I think it's getting a little too crazy, I'll say, well, you know, maybe we should go in this direction. And, you know, so it's a push and pull kind of thing between the two of us until we end up with something that's as factual and scientific as we know how to make it. And so what we're doing in Watchers 10 is that we'll be releasing actual DNA results from what we've been finding down in Peru. And
oh, really?
We already have some of the results, and we have three labs currently working on it. We're waiting for some final results, but what we found so far is so shocking. And I don't know. I wish I could say what it is, but I can't release it yet. And I'm hoping for even more information within the next 2 weeks. We should have more, but there's different processes involved in getting DNA tested. Some labs have the equipment and some don't. And we realized to do some of this paleo DNA with this ancient DNA that we needed a machine that's about $250,000 to purchase. And it's called Next Generation Sequencing. And it basically, it's like shining an extra 100,000 flashlights onto a sample to try to find DNA from it. And by doing that, you get a lot more chance of discovering what's in there. So would you like to hear how we stumbled across this Peruvian skull?
Absolutely.
I mean, it's really kind of
interesting. Yeah, absolutely.
Last year, I was showing Watchers 8 at the UFO International Congress in Arizona. And I went backstage and I gave him a Blu-ray disc of it so they could show it in HD. And I had in my hand a casting of the baby mummy skull that we unwrapped in Watchers 8. And they wanted me to go out on stage and present the film before we actually roll it. And so I went out and showed everybody this. But backstage, the guy said, "Oh, I have one of those." And I said, "I mean, that's just a very bizarre thing for someone to tell you, because nobody is usually walking into a building holding a skull in their hand. And this is my life now." He whips out his cell phone and shows me this picture of this enormous skull, which I immediately recognized as coming from Peru, because we've done so much research down there, you just wouldn't know. But anyway, I said, "This looks like a Peruvian skull." I said, "Yeah, it is." And I said, "You have this skull at home?" And he said, "Yeah." And I said, "Well, how did you happen upon that?" And he said, "It's been in my family for decades." Evidently, his father was traveling in Peru. His father was studying this stuff and just brought it home with him on the plane, because back in those days, no one cared. And it looks like it came out of a museum. It had markings on the forehead like museums in Peru normally do. If you look at that really big picture of the Chongo skull that's so famous, it's like written as this Chongos on the forehead, you know. Well, this had the inscription of a little mining town in Peru, and it was almost as big as the Chongo skull from the Ica Museum in Peru. Huh. And I said, "Wow, we've been trying to get samples out of Peru to do DNA testing." And I said, "We've been working on it at that time for a year. And because of red tape and archaeologists that drag their feet, we would pay people to get the paperwork done for us in Peru, and they'd go dark for 6 weeks. We wouldn't hear back at all from it. We'd send more money down there to get them working on it. Nothing. Nothing ever became of it. So I said, "You know, we would like to do some DNA testing. Would you mind if we came up and took some samples of your skull?" He said, "No, not at all." So we found ourselves on a plane up to Oregon, and then we had to drive another four and a half hours to this very remote little town, Ashland, Oregon. And there's this gigantic skull. I mean, it's just huge, enormous. It's in the Watchers 10 graphic. And so we used special tools and wore special clothing and gloves and took some samples. Now, the way you take samples from a skull correctly is everything has to be completely clean. You have to have a clean environment. And this particular skull, since it was a museum piece, had been varnished. They'd put a shellac over it to protect it. Well, according to DNA experts, that's not the worst thing that can happen, because if you drill down below that shellac, you're still into virgin DNA territory that hasn't been touched by human hands. And what you try to do, you use a tool, a Dremel Moto tool, and you drill down below that, and you once you penetrate the surface, we used those little pocket dust-off cans with compressed air to blow it out to get rid of the dust from the lacquer. And then we started drilling into the bone tissue, and then it would collect on a clean sheet of paper, which then went into an envelope. And so we managed to get this powder from the skull from several different places. We did the mandible, which is the lower jaw. We did into the side of the head. We did it on the bottom where the foramen magnum is located. I think we did something near the zygomatic arch. So we took it from several different places, and we even sawed a tiny piece of bone off. There was a big cracked area in the very back of the skull, which is indicative of all of these skulls. Most of them have a large hole in the back, usually from some sort of blunt force trauma or a possible pickaxe digging it up. But in most cases, and with even Indian legends that we've heard, these were not nice people, and they were killed by a blow to the head. And that's the evidence that we've seen repeatedly on these elongated heads, is that was indeed the case.
Mm-hmm.
So those samples are being tested now, and then we were allowed to take some of the baby mummy's hair out of the country. They did allow us to do that officially. And so that hair is being tested, and we got 11% DNA off of the hair, which is really good. I mean, they didn't expect to get that good of a sample.
Hmm.
So we already have a relative place of origin where those two skull samples came from on the earth.
Mm-hmm.
And that is what I can't reveal yet, and we still want to get more information, but what I can tell you is we had the skulls carbon dated, and that is very interesting, and a lot of people are shocked. I know Dan Gordon, when I told him the age of the really big skull from Oregon, he goes, no freaking way. And I said,
huh.
It's the big skull is only 900 years old.
Wow.
Oh, really?
The baby mummy skull was 1930 years old.
Interesting.
So that in that case, this jives with the North American Native Indian basically oral tradition of what was going on during that time, about 900 to 1,000 years ago. Totally goes with what they said was going on in North America. There were giants in North America. 8.5, 9 footers, most likely, by what we can tell. Some with 6 fingers and 6 toes, double rows of teeth, and they were cannibalistic. And according to Chief Joseph is a Native American Indian that is a Christian and has basically given us his understanding of the folklore from about 1,000 years ago, how all of the Indian tribes that fought the giants banded together and still to this day have that link, that bond. And you would find these giants buried in the Ohio River Valley, typically. And like I think I was saying last time, there are press articles in the New York Times and in the LA Times saying that people would be digging in their backyards. And in the 1880s, one of the articles was written in 1882. There was another one in the early 1900s, and I guess into the 1920s is about the last you hear of it. But that the people were finding giants in their backyards. And so the Bureau of Ethnology would come and exhume the body. And according to the newspaper articles, in some cases, the newspapers would say that these bones would be taken to the Smithsonian for national study. And today, if you call the Smithsonian, they don't know what you're talking about. But we have proof.
Well,
unless you're saying that these newspapers were lying, we have proof by these articles that something happened and was sent to the Smithsonian in those days.
Well, in Steve Quayle's book, Larry, you can correct me if I'm wrong here, but didn't he say the largest one they found so far is like 36 feet tall?
I cannot really remember Steve's. I know Klaus Dona's. He talks about the bones that he's found, and he said they were running 25 to 30 foot tall, really, really giants. And he's talking about, he goes down to Peru and Chile and also Ecuador, and a lot of that being found there. And interestingly, too, guys, is the fact that since I live up here in the area of Texas, that rock wall, which I know Richard, you and L.A. have visited during a very tornado season, and there are reports, and I've read some of the old papers reports, that they did find more under that wall before they built that freeway over it to cover it up, and most of downtown, I guess, rock wall, that there was giant equipment and stuff, and even axes and axe heads and things that were down there, that they covered all this up. And you've been there, though, but you guys didn't get a lot other than the rock, I guess.
That's true. We've been to Rockwall, and we talked to an expert there that told us about his excavation, and some of it, I guess, was underneath where they put City Hall today in Rockwall. So you can't really dig under there and really discover what it is. Again, it's like another cover-up. And yet, the lore about Rock Wall is unprovable. I mean, the wall exists, and there were pictures of it. It had, like, openings in it, like, looked like ancient windows, that kind of thing. And the wall was incredibly dense material. It looks like, if I remember right, it's like andesite or a similar stone. It seemed to have quartz in it. It probably piezoelectric. We'd heard reports that at one point a tractor was idling over part of rock wall, and all of a sudden the whole ground started trembling and shaking because the machinery in the tractor was somehow affecting the rock that it was sitting on and making the whole rock formation resonate. That's what a piezoelectric thing does when it's, you know, voltage is applied or vibration is applied. And that's how that stuff works. But as far as pulling huge giants out of rock wall, we haven't seen evidence of that, although we've heard rumors that that there was a gigantic pot found in a cave underground in rock wall with human bones in it. It looked like it was, you know, someone was cooking something. That there were other really large bones in that area. I mean, that's part of folklore. I can't tell you whether that's true or not. I mean, it wouldn't surprise me, but since we know that these giants were cannibalistic, it wouldn't surprise me if that were the case. But I can't swear to it. Here's something else interesting about the rock wall thing, Larry, since you asked. I don't know if you remember that far back, but in Watchers 4, we were told that there was a powder that was coating some of the wall, and if you looked at that powder under a microscope, it was made of little tetrahedrons and little round balls that interlocked. Do you remember that?
Yes, I do. I remember that well.
Well, that always intrigued me, and so on one of our trips to SEAL Labs in Los Angeles, I said, L.A., while we're there testing this stuff, this is when Roger was still alive, when we were working on Watcher 7, I said, see if you can get him to send us some of that dust, and then we'll put it under the microscope and see if that's true. So it took a couple weeks to get it in, but we got a little vial of that dust, and I couldn't wait. I said, Steve, stick this under there. I got to see what this looks like. So he puts it under the microscope, and, you know, you have to put it on a little post that has, like, sticky stuff on it to hold it in place, and then you put it on this aluminum post, and it's energized. And you close the door to the electron microscope, and then all of the air is pumped out of the chamber, and it takes a couple minutes for that to happen because it has to be in a vacuum. And then you can start looking at your sample. And when we got the dust under the microscope and looked at it, we all concurred. It just looked like normal silicon. It just looked like sand. There was nothing unusual about it. There was no tetrahedral shapes or little round balls. It all looked just like normal beach sand, except maybe a little finer. So either the sample that this man thought would contain that type of sample, maybe he couldn't tell. Just, you know, how would you know whether this dust or this dust is going to have that characteristic?
Yeah,
because it's microscopic. But in any case, what we were sent just was normal. So this is why we have to always vet everything we put out in our watchers, because we're dealing with some pretty weird stuff here.
Yeah,
we really are.
Yeah.
It's weird.
Say, speaking about, I'm drifting here a little bit. You talked about the implants on our last show. Has anybody ever done any DNA testing on them?
Well, implants, typically, I have seen rare occasions where there's strange, like, wart-like shapes that weren't on people's skin. I don't know what those are. But in most cases, implants are metallic, so you wouldn't get DNA off of an inorganic substance like that.
Right, right. I had heard some of them were more biological. Have you heard that?
Well, there is a coating. There's a coating that they emit. Now, I don't know what you would achieve doing a test on the coating. Now we've done that in a we've had labs look at the coating and to detect whether there's any inflammation or infection, and it always comes up negative. For some reason, the coating that the implant emits, however it's doing it, shields the metal object from irritating the lining that it's in. Because normally if you have a sliver under your skin or you have a piece of steel under there, your body wants to constantly work to push it out. And in the case of an implant, it's like your body doesn't even know it's in there. So it's very strange. I mean, and normally the implants are in my experience, in what we've done, we've done EDX analysis of them, they tend to be of a high nickel iron content, almost to the same percentage as some meteoric particles you might find. It's not like a normal percentage. I mean, it's iron and nickel. Sometimes there's some titanium in there, oxygen. And if you find carbon, it's usually remnants of tissue from the human body that it was attached to that comes up in the test.
And also, though, didn't you say also that y'all found that they have a frequency, that they do emit a frequency at times?
Yes, while they're still connected to a nerve, they appear in many occasions to emit a very high frequency, like radio frequency in the FM band. Sure. Now, I think there's some debate on what that frequency is. At one time, Roger thought it was 330 gigahertz, but I've since had conversations with two prominent scientists who say, well, that's like in a microwave region where it would actually cook the skin, if that were the case. So we think it might be 330 megahertz. So
what would
but
that
still,
be for?
We don't know, other than I have theories. I do have theories of my own about it. I think it's, personally feel, it's bidirectional communication. I think that they're basically able to read signals coming from the human body and inject signals into it. I think this is why that our the guy that came in that we used that to test to see if he had an implant, that particular specimen, he had problems where he would have sudden bursts of pain in his leg from that implant that would cause him to have to lay down in agony. And it was nothing he did, and it was nothing that was hitting his leg. It just would go off. And when after it was removed, that never happened again. So I think, you know, ages ago, people thought this was a tracking device. And we since believe that that's really not necessary. If they wanted to track us, they could track us with our DNA without even needing any kind of implant at all.
What about mind control, hallucinations, et cetera?
Well, I mean, there's this idea. I don't know if they're allowed to do that. But there are people, and you can verify this. I mean, I know how crazy this sounds and how crazy I probably sound to some people.
No.
I'm just I'm just telling you guys what we've discovered, people that I've met, x-rays that we've taken, and the results in the lab. That's all I can do.
Mm-hmm.
And I know people that have implants in the center of their brain behind each ear. And if you take them in and x-ray their head, you can clearly see them. Now, how did that get in there? I mean, we can't do that without killing the patient.
Mm-hmm.
But these people have implants. And so one guy that I know that has that, who confided in me and told me, who I won't mention his name because it was in confidence, but that told me, I said, so what do you think that they're doing? What's that for? He said, they're probably monitoring what I see and hear. And I said, well, that's interesting. And then he freaked me out by saying they probably know this conversation we're having right now. And then after that, I had nightmares.
So really what you're saying is they, if that scenario is true, you become a human transmitter as to what you see, hear, say, et cetera, et cetera.
Well, yeah, then you have these people, the same people have adventures on spaceships and things that they barely remember. They may be taken up on a spaceship to have sex with some alien being.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, according to Dr. David Jacobs, we have hybrids walking amongst us now that are coming to live in people's apartments and pawning themselves off as being human, and they're really not, totally. And in Watcher 6, we were able to analyze a hair from someone who Roger believed to be a hybrid individual. And so Steve Colburn did a Raman spectroscopy test on that hair, which has to do with molecular vibrations and what elements come up when you do that. It's some particular organic compounds can be damaged in an electron microscope when you apply high voltage. So Raman spectroscopy is a bit easier on organic samples like hairs and things like that. And so what we found fascinating, we did a controlled test with hairs from one of the skulls in Peru, the hair from the hybrid, and then a hair, Steve plucked a hair out of his head and stuck it in a test, and then a woman who had dyed her hair, we had that sample. So we had four hair samples just as a control test, two as a control test, and two that we were curious to see what they'd look like. And what was interesting is the hybrid, the person who claimed to be a hybrid human and one of the elongated head hair samples tracked point for point. And Steve's hair went off the scale and didn't look anything like anything else. And the woman that had dyed her hair was so far off the map that it wasn't even, by the time you put it on the same chart, it was like completely different. So what I thought was interesting is that here we have a hair from a 1930-year-old mummy that tracked point per point with a human hybrid hair that we were given.
Incredible.
Now I have to tell you something.
So this kind of reminds me of the new movie that's out, Fifth Wave.
I haven't seen that.
Larry, you want to elaborate maybe on that?
Yeah, it's kind of interesting because the Fifth Wave, it just came out. Matter of fact, I picked it up at Walmart the other day, and I had heard about some of those movies or books earlier, but I hadn't read any of them. But the Fifth Wave, what shocked me, you know, and of course it's supposed to be fiction, but there's an invasion, an alien invasion that uses Earth changes and catastrophes to invade the planet, basically. But what's so interesting to me is the military literally goes out, and, you know, it's almost like my so-called arrival dream experience that I had, to where an arrival came and the police and the military were rounding everybody up. And in the Fifth Wave, what shocked me was how that they loaded all the children up on school buses and drove them to military compounds, and they slaughtered the family members, the adults. All the adults were killed. And I thought, wow, this is almost like, you know, that vision I had. And so I found it rather striking.
Well, that's interesting. I mean,
yeah. Go ahead.
I'm sorry.
Yeah.
I was saying, we're leaking information.
Well, it seems like in that movie, the aliens also took on human form. You couldn't tell the difference.
Well, this is something that I've often said to people that think we're nuts and that we shouldn't be trying to get information about UFOs from the biblical scriptures, and those people just don't understand that if we were to see what the Bible called an angel in those days, would we not consider it an alien today by our upbringing that we have? You know, the people that the prophets and those who were inspired to write in the Old Testament, that it had these experiences, and even in the New Testament, later when we had, you know, when Peter was in prison and all of that, they were trying to describe these angelic beings and their ability, and they seem to have telepathic abilities in the scriptures. And now when we compare that to what's happening with abductions and with people that have had experiences with actual aliens, and you know they're not lying to you, they're telling actual stories of what happened to them. They're very similar, except one is rather dark and oppressive, and the other is full of light and good stuff. And there's two sides to the whole story. And without studying the spiritual aspect, you can't understand the UFO ET phenomena, in my opinion.
Exactly. Yeah, exactly. In fact, without the Bible, you're kind of lost as to what's really happening.
Well, yeah. There's no pinning point to know what's real and what's not, what's truth and what's not true. And a lot of people aren't going to have a clue what's going on when this actually happens. I kind of get the feeling that they're going to be looking to people like Stephen Bassett for answers. And maybe they'll look L.A. Marzulli and I and people of that, where we've been studying this and putting this out for a number of years now. Or they'll just consider us some kind of Bible freaks and just discount the whole thing, anything we say. You know, they might do that. Because I really think that Stephen Bassett believes that this will be the best thing to ever happen to us when these aliens appear. Finally, we'll have, you know, knowledge to solve our problems. We can take care of all of the nuclear, you know, emissions in Fukushima. We can, you know, fix global warming. We can, you know, do everything, that these beings will help us.
Mm-hmm.
But that, and that may indeed occur for a while, but after that, I think it's all hell will break loose. But we're already seeing how we're already moving towards, I mean, everything the Bible has said is happening. I mean, blow by blow. I mean, you know, everything that's happening in the Middle East right now and the situation with Damascus and Syria, and all of that. And it's just, it's astonishing that we're getting to see these things in our lifetime happen. And so there's crazy things that go on in the book of Revelation. book of Revelation reads more like science fiction than any other part of the Bible. But if you look at it through these eyes, if you're looking at it through current science and technology and sci-fi that we're used to seeing in theaters, I mean, Revelation begins to look rather tame in comparison.
Yes.
Have you guys heard of the, it's another wave, I mean, we've had the flat earth movement, which is completely bogus. But then there's another thing that's happened, and it's been kind of generated by fears about what they're doing at CERN. And I just find that interesting, where they believe that CERN may have changed the dimension that we're living in. People are saying that they remember stuff that is no longer the same way that it used to be. Now, this is unprovable, but have you guys heard about this?
I have heard a little bit, and you know, interestingly, Stuart, you know, you claimed also that you thought with CERN that they were going to attempt some type of time experiment or a movement in time or something to change something. And maybe you want to elaborate on that. But something, there are reports come in different places that seem to indicate something seems to be different. You know, I know cosmically the planets, it's all a little bit different. Times seem to be different. The sun rises and sets. The timing seems to be off. There's a lot of things, you can see that things are not right. However, there is some that are saying that something's not quite right with things.
Well, this particular effect is called the Mandela effect. Have you guys heard of that?
I can't say I have.
What they're saying is that there have been a lot of things, it's almost like quantum theory, and that they were worshiping the goddess Shiva at CERN. Now, I've heard that for months now, that was going on.
Uh-huh.
And that they were possibly trying to open up a portal using this technology. Now, there's all of this stuff in the book of Revelation where it's talking of, and a great pit opened up, and all these creatures flew out. And, I mean, all of these crazy things happen that you'd see in like a Marvel Comics film almost, you know, which is interesting to me, like in The Avengers, there was a portal open in space and all these evil creatures came down through. Remember that?
Mm-hmm.
Well, according to the Mandela effect, things have been subtly altered. Like, and the way that they're giving examples, like the Ford logo is different than it used to be. Now, if you go back and look at older pictures of it, it looks the same as it does now. But people don't remember that it looks like it does now. People say, well, no, it didn't have the little curly Q that it has now. Things like that. Another one is like the Chick-fil-A logo. Now, years ago, I worked on a project for a walk through the Bible where we actually interviewed Stuart Caffey, who is the CEO of Chick-fil-A, and he said they were selling over $1 billion a year of chicken. And I remember when I was editing that show together that I had to font his name and the Chick-fil-A logo. And I remember looking it up so I'd spell it correctly, and to the best of my remembrance, it was CHICFIL-A.
Mm.
Well, now if you look at Chick-fil-A, it's CHICK-FIL-A.
Mm. Well, could this
you,
be
any of you remember it being CHIC?
Well,
no, I don't.
No, I can't. I can't say I do remember.
Well, see, I could be wrong. That's the thing. It's unprovable. And so I have to study this effect a bit more to see if there's anything to it at all or if it's complete baloney. I'm not convinced yet, but there's a lot of information that's emerging suddenly on the Internet about it. It's something I wouldn't put it past it.
Well, if you could change perceptions in the mind, then, of course, everything changes. But
well,
I don't
right,
think you
there's
could do
that, but
universally.
This would be an interdimensional shift.
Yes.
And I know, like, I've talked to people who've had near-death experiences, like Howard Storm. And also, I have heard people, like, I don't know if you've seen, read Danny and Brinkley's book, Saved by the Light. Very interesting near-death experience, where he was hit by a lightning bolt through his phone and was dead for 30 minutes and had this enormous experience. Well, he was kind of fried internally by that lightning bolt. And Howard Storm was had this hole in his stomach where hydrochloric acid spilled out into the inside of his body and started cooking it from the inside out. And so those kind of injuries take months to heal. They're very complicated, and your body has to go through the process of cleansing itself from all of that. And Howard said that for months, he wasn't sure what dimension he was in. Things were like passing in front of him. He would see beings in his hospital room that he wasn't sure whether they were there or if they were in another dimension that he was looking into. This is something I've heard people that have had near-death experiences comment about. So we know that there are other dimensions. I don't know, maybe God is so powerful he just gets bored easily. He hasn't made enough stars, so he wants to, like, triple and quadruple the size of the universe by having other universes within the universe we're in. I don't know. It's all really incredible to me, but apparently
there are a number of incidences where there was one where this aviator, a lady, was flying, I believe it was over the Bahamas. I think Larry probably knows about this one. And she called in to the airport operators down there and said that she couldn't see the airport. And she was flying almost overhead. And
was this
so
a
Bermuda
Triangle
just,
kind of thing?
Yeah, and they told her to just circle because the airport was right underneath her. And if she'd just tip her bank, you know, then she'd see it. And so she did that. She made the circle, a steep bank, and she said, no, there's no airport here. It's just forest. It's just woods. There's nothing here. And they said, but we can see you. We can see you. And anyway, she finally just took off. They never saw her again. So did she jump dimensions? And
there seems to be places on the earth where the fabric of the dimensions has thinned. I don't know what else to say. We hear these stories every so often that's actually happening.
Yeah, it actually happened in my family with my dad and my mom, and they were not drunk. They had not even had a drink. They'd gone to play cards with a neighbor, but somehow got lost. And they came upon this town that they had never seen before, never heard of, etc. And my dad said we drove down into it, but he said there was something wrong. He finally got spooked and left. Well, they went to find it, and no such town existed. So what happened? You know? I mean, how does that work?
Well, there's so many crazy things right now. I mean, there's these floating cities in China that have been on the internet now for the past year.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, are those Project Bluebeam or... are they real cities, or we don't know?
That's a good question. I think a lot of this is, frankly, my own opinion, and my opinion only. It's Bluebeam. They have now photographed airplanes in flight that look for all the world. One of them was a military. It's clear as day. It's a military heavy loader or whatever you want to call them, freighter. One is a major airline, and they videotape this thing, and you see it flying along normally, then it stops, and then it vanishes. Now, that's got to be holographic.
You would think so, unless it's unless we're talking about a dimensional shift kind of thing, but then we're getting verging into like unprovable sci-fi stuff.
Yes, it's kind of like what Noy says in her book. Are you familiar with Phoenix Rising at all?
Oh, I mean, I know about the Phoenix Lights.
No, this is a book that was written by Mary Summer Rain, and she met this Indian shaman woman who was blind, and so they called her Noise. That was her name. And I had Red Elk came to our studio, and I videotaped him and interviewed him, and I asked him about this Noise, and he said, yes, he knew her. Personally. Anyway, she died some time ago. But this is what she says. Listen to this. Kind of interesting. She says, let's see. I want to start here where it's right. People's going to see new beings. Beings going to come more, much more. They come from there. She points to the sky. Mary Summerane says, you mean the alien beings, the UFOs? Remaining very serious, Noyes nodded. Beings going to show more and more. They know going to play games. They no longer going to hide, no longer going to play games. It be time they show they be here all along. So that's probably it's an enigma.
I think that's happening. Yeah, I think, well, you know, scriptures also say the one who holds them back. Now, it doesn't really say who that is. Maybe it's like one of the archangels is in charge of that. And, you know, we read about the Prince of Persia and having to fight off through all of that, what was going on. There's definitely entities out there, and they're visible at this point. I mean, people are, this is not unusual what I'm saying. There's UFOs that are seen constantly all over the world and in every major city. And people are filming them now. And what we don't have yet, or at least good pictures of it, we've got some really fuzzy and indistinct images of actual aliens walking around. Don't think it's going to be a very happy place when that happens. That could happen. It wouldn't surprise me if it happened, let me put it that way. None of this would surprise me, because to me it's like this is all inevitable. I mean,
yeah, have you ever talked to Stan Deo? He did a lot of research on the ancient language that Daniel wrote, and he says the same thing you just said. When they get here, it is going to be very unpleasant.
Yeah, I think it will be. I really don't want to be here if they're here. I really don't. I don't think it's going to be. I don't think it'll be a pleasant time. I mean, these beings are known to be consummate liars and incredibly evil, at least people that have contacted them. Now, not all of them have been that way. Not all of them. This is where L.A. and I have had long discussions. I said, L.A., they can't all be evil. It's not the way God does things normally. He usually has a balance, and you know, allows so much evil through, and then there's also good stuff. And you know, angels that are good always say, be not afraid, all of that. The ones that took Enoch away were very respectful of him, took him away. After warning him he was going to be leaving his family for a little while. You know, that's not the typical scenario that that you know, Colonel Robert Solis had when he was lifted off his bed and passed through a window and ended up on a spaceship with a big probe put down his vital organs. That is not something that the good angels are doing to us. And yet you have a lot of people who don't believe these ancient texts that are basically think, well, they're just experimenting because they're trying to do thus and so, or this is part of their, it's not good or evil, this is just who they are and what they're curious about us, and so they're experimenting on us, et cetera, et cetera. Well, according to Dr. Jacobs, they're trying to create a genetic hybrid is what all of this is all about. That's the whole point of it. And this is like, goes clear back. This is why the study of the Nephilim is important, because it's the same kind of deal where you're creating a human hybrid. That's what the Nephilim were, essentially. They were
yes.
a human hybrid. And actually, Jesus Christ was a hybrid, if you want to get down
absolutely.
To it. People are going to go, oh my gosh, this is blasphemy. No, it's not.
No, it isn't. It's true.
part God and part man. Now, we don't know how
yes.
that worked. And even today, the idea of a virgin birth, well, okay, we know how that's done now. Okay. Scientifically, that's possible. I mean, there's all of this stuff, you know, where you can pass through walls and do all the things that angels and aliens are able to do. This is old hat to them. This is no big deal. Just because we don't understand it doesn't mean it's scientifically impossible.
Yes, absolutely.
So I think that, okay, so Mary was impregnated in a specific way. Okay, that seems totally, I mean, not nearly as crazy and as weird as it might have seemed 50 years ago to people. Now it's like, well, okay. I mean, there's women that are having artificial insemination done to them on a routine basis.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
You know, and these people that have had alien encounters, there's, you know, they've taken sperm from men and in a laboratory kind of environment, you know. No, that's all. I don't know what else to say about it. I don't see it as being all that unbelievable at all.
Well, one of the things that's happened, I think, is that people have become, how do I say, they've got blinders on their eyes. They can't seem to open up to anything that is be abnormal to them. They just
right.
deny it because it makes them feel better to deny it. They get uncomfortable if they start. It's kind of like going to a good sci-fi movie that's very frightening, but you walk out of the theater and you say, boy, I'm glad that's just a movie.
Exactly. Well, one of my favorite films is the old Independence Day that came out like, what, 95, 96, something like that. And the scene where they're in the bar and the guy who was abducted before is now a drunkard and he's there getting a drink and all the guys are making fun of him. And the one guy goes, well, when they got him on board that ship, they abused him sexually. And they were like really getting their jollies
yeah.
about that. Until this mile-wide spacecraft hung over where they were. Like, okay. And a lot of people are going to be just like that. They're going to be just that dumb that they don't realize this stuff is a reality, and now what do we do, you know? And they
yeah.
never studied the scriptures to know really what's supposed to have happened. And they wouldn't believe the scriptures if they'd read them anyway, because there are people that aren't going to believe. And I've ask God this over and over. Why do so many people have to be fooled? I don't understand it, but I would say the majority of people will not know what this is, and they'll just buy it hook, line, and sinker. It's kind of like us. We need to warn people about this, of what is about to happen, and we don't know when it's going to happen, but by all evidences that we're seeing, we're rapidly approaching that point in history where this is about to happen.
Yes. Well, it's in Thessalonians, I believe, Second Thessalonians. Even him who's coming is after lying signs and wonders to basically deceive the world. And if you follow modern science and the evolutionary process as they present it, which I don't believe, I think the Bible teaches clearly creation and what they are calling evolution, I'm convinced, is really wide-ranging adaptability within families, species. So when the environment changes, the species can adapt to a certain limit. And when that limit is reached, they perish. They die off. You have an extinction event. And they're taking this as evolutionary when in reality it isn't. Because the Bible's very,
right.
very clear. Creation is the order of the day. But it's very easy to see where science, which is anti-God in the first place, in some ways anyway, it has to be, or it's not objective. But, you know, that would answer that question, and I can understand fully why they would call it evolution when in fact it isn't.
Right. I think they take great liberties with evolution where they have species jumping across other species boundaries and becoming something else. It just isn't going to happen. I mean, there's basically, if you build a cat, it's going to be a cat. It's not going to turn into a bird over a period of a million years. You know?
Well,
it might eat several birds.
What's so interesting, too, is you wonder... Or I've often wondered, you know, they always show the ape in the middle of the species jump. And what's so interesting is people wonder if God may have went to sleep because why are there still apes?
Right, exactly. They have a different number of chromosomes than humans have and everything. They're completely different. You know, I think God gets a kick out of making creatures that look like other creatures. I think he does it on purpose. It's like, oh, let me make this animal that kind of looks like a person that's just really goofy and hangs by his tail. That would be fun. Point. There he does, you know. So he does that for his own pleasure. He gets off on being creative. That's what God is all about. That's why he's
yes.
so cool, because he can do that stuff. I get excited about that. It's like, great, you know, make an alien being. That doesn't take my faith down a notch at all. It just means that he's just made more kooky, cool stuff, stuff that I'd like to see. You know, I don't particularly want to associate with evil aliens, but I'm always wanting to know what God does, because I think it's fascinating, for heaven's sake.
You know,
well,
what's
interesting, too, is
yeah,
I was just going to say, mention there where you were talking about making cool stuff. It's very interesting that the original creations were always, you know, the word would say they were good, except
they were good.
When the counterfeiter came by, though, he always seemed to, what he did to adapt or change that same creation turned into monsters. And in the book of Esdras, which I don't ask anybody to believe, but I like Esdras, it talks about in the end times that women will give birth to monsters.
Right. Now, I've read that. That's interesting. And that's what's happening in some cases. And we've got, like, strange shifts in DNA, and we've got radioactive... they're having weird creatures born in the Fukushima area now, stuff that I've seen, you know, double-headed sea creatures.
Mutations.
It's weird.
Another thing I want to bounce off both you guys. When you're dealing with the UFO and you're dealing with the arrival and when you're dealing with the intercourse, so to speak, of the aliens with humanity, is it possible that what we perceive might be going on, like you were saying, well, they want to produce a race of hybrids and run the world or... whatever the scenario is, could all those scenarios be totally false, because what they really want to do, totally destroy the human race altogether.
Oh, yeah, that's pretty much, I kind of think that's what the overall plan is.
So
yeah,
that would be
say, yeah, Stuart, I was just going to agree with you that probably all the other, tale of the Twin Cities and all of that is basically smoke and mirrors, actually. But the end goal is to destroy or stop in its tracks the Adamic race.
Well, that would
be and there's all of these. I agree with you guys on that. I think that's true. And everything that we see that's evil that pops up in these ancient texts is the copycat technology of the good stuff that God has done, which is like keep always going back to Ezekiel 9, where the good people in Israel at the time that were written about in that book were given a mark on their forehead, and everyone else was killed. Well, in the end of days, people that have a mark on their forehead or on their hand are allowed to buy and sell.
Mm-hmm.
It's copycat technology. We don't know what the mark on the forehead was in a book of Ezekiel.
Mm-hmm.
A mark could be a number of things. It could be a device that's inserted. It could just be like blood on the doorpost, like it was during the Passover. We don't know what it was, but I have a
mm-hmm.
feeling that it could have been a very high-tech thing, because these guys that came down to kill everybody were not said to have swords or daggers. They had powerful weapons. Now, what kind of weapons is that? I've always been curious to know what that was. But it wasn't to kill everyone in that area with six guys with knives would have been taken a month, most likely. But it didn't seem like they had any trouble dispatching that many people in a matter of minutes or hours.
Well, I don't think we have any clue as to the technology. I know Stan Deo worked with Dr. Teller, and some of the things that they were working on, the average person, if they were exposed to it, would think it was the gods themselves.
Mm-hmm. Well,
because
I'm sure
it's so advanced.
Yeah, there's all kinds of technology that I'm sure that we have that no one knows about. It's frustrating.
Well, when I was working for a guy down in Texas, the plant manager had a brother that worked at Los Alamos. And we got to talking about a little bit of it, and he said, all I can say is, this is what my brother told me, that if the American people knew how far advanced they really are, they'd probably demand it be shut down. It's that spooky, the stuff that they're doing.
Or, I mean, there's a book that came out a while back and called In League with a UFO. And in that book, it relates what happened to the Roswell craft and what it was like inside and the aliens that they met. And this was a guy that I wanted to interview on Watchers, and I thought we were going to get to do it, and then he went dark. His name is Lou Baldin, B-A-L-D-I-N, and the book is called In League with the UFO. But in that, they talked about where they were taking, like, a homeless guy, and they were pulling the life force out of his body and putting it into somebody else. These creatures, these beings had the ability to do that, according to this book. The ship also was I don't know if it was, you'd call it nanotechnology or whatever, but at the atomic level, it was able to almost organically repair itself So after a few days, the big hole in the side of the ship where it crashed had completely sealed itself and was completely like new again.
And almost like a
that
plant.
Part, I tend to believe that only because, remember, Gary Stearman, who had an experience with a UFO, said that when it got close to his airplane, it felt like it was alive, he told me.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Well,
and
you know, that's
in
interesting.
Ezekiel, it talks about it being alive.
Well, it probably, you know, we don't know how much power the fallen ones have. I mean, if you go into the early ancient literature, they were shapeshifters. So the whole thing could be just a fake. And it is alive.
I think these craft could be actual, like, creatures of themselves, or some kind of a device that's so far advanced to our own building techniques that we can't really understand it. I know, like Bob Lazar once said, it'd be like throwing a guy in a covered wagon an iPhone and asking him to duplicate it.
Yeah. Well, what you're saying kind of reminds me of what Red Elk told me, and I don't know if Larry's talked to Red Elk quite a bit before he died, but he said that a good share of these UFOs that we're seeing are literally almost like plants. They're kind of like, I don't even know how to, a pea pod or something of that nature that heals itself when it gets damaged, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. In other words, it's living. But he really didn't say whether it was biologically alive or exactly what kind of technology was involved. He didn't know. It's kind of like Bigfoot. Who is Bigfoot? What is Bigfoot? Are there different types of Bigfoot? Are you investigating that aspect in your Watcher series?
Oh, yeah, absolutely. In fact, we're good friends with Ron Moorhead, who has made that his life's study is Bigfoot. Did I mention about what happened with the man that is in Watchers 10 who said that they shot a giant in Afghanistan? I can't remember if I mentioned that. I don't want to keep repeating myself.
We knew about it, but go ahead and elaborate what you can without revealing too much.
Yeah, I'm trying to find one second, I'm just looking up something here that I thought was interesting. If I can find it fast enough, if not, I'll drop it. Oh, here we go. We were talking about the UFOs being alive, that concept. In Ezekiel chapter 10, it said, it's talking about the creature, when the cherubim moved, the wheels beside them moved. And when the cherubim stood still, they also stood still. When the cherubim rose, they rose with them, because the spirit of the living creatures was in them.
Yes.
Makes it sound like, as if this device that Ezekiel saw was alive. So when I hear Gary Stearman tell me that he knew that this craft was alive, he could sense that it was. And then I read this in this book, in League with a UFO, about a craft repairing itself, like almost like growing part of it back again. Then when we go back into biblical text and read something like that, it gives us me a little bit more basis of formulating an hypothesis of that may be possible.
So is it possible that the UFOs we're seeing that look like UFOs? I mean, obviously there's reverse technology. We know, I don't know whether you believe Bob Lazar. I certainly do. I think Stan Dale believes some of it. I don't know if he believes all of it. But
I think he's telling the truth.
I've
always felt like he has.
That's what I thought. I really did. Because he said later on in an interview, he wished he'd never opened his mouth at all. But he thought he was doing a favor to the human race by releasing what he knew. And, of course, they just ridiculed it, which is, of course,
well, the movie I mentioned earlier that Independence Day, a lot of the information in that movie wouldn't have been in there had it not been for Bob Lazar's story. Because no one before Bob Lazar spilled the beans knew anything about Area 51 or Groom Lake or any of that stuff and what was going
yes.
on there. And that was a big, big thing in the movie that they brought out. And he's been approached by movie companies wanting to do his story, and he never wants to let them do it because he figures they'll goof it up and make it seem goofy or silly, and it's a serious stuff to him. He doesn't want it to be treated that way, and I can understand that.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, it was kind of like the remarks
yeah, you know,
that Dan Gordon said about what Hollywood does to your work.
You know, Stuart, remember years ago, Stuart, I had an experience where I had been praying about translation of the removal of Enoch and the removal of Elijah. You know, I was studying some of that, and I was
mm-hmm.
in prayer, and I was shown, you know, talking about what was it that actually transported Enoch to another place and maybe another dimension. What transported Elijah in a different manner or same manner? You know, and then they made the movie, recently they had a movie where Ezekiel's wheels were involved, but Knowing, I believe. But anyway,
yes.
I was
right.
praying about that, and Stuart, years ago I told you that it was really a strange experience, and the only thing that what I was shown in the experience was the closest thing in English I could tell you, Stuart, was that they were living machines in a very supernatural type of way, you know. And it makes me wonder, guys, if the original creator has creatures that are transportation devices in a way, a form, a fashion that are multidimensional, is it possible that we are trying to, or someone is trying to create the same type of situation with AI?
Good
artificial
point.
Intelligence.
I totally think that anything's possible. I think what's happening right now, which is there's all this human genetic experimentation going on in China and in other countries where they're trying to merge other animals with human DNA, and it's really creepy and scary. This may be, you know, where women are having monsters. This could be the fulfillment of such a thing. I mean, we're dealing with stuff that we have no idea what we're dealing with. And in Greek mythos, you know, there was like half man, half horse, that type of thing. And we may be starting to see that kind of thing happen again.
Yes.
Before all is
I've always
done.
Thought that. I really have. I always thought that Greek mythology was actually true for the most part. That
yeah.
they were fooling
yeah.
around with genetics, and they were making anything they could dream up to see how it worked.
Well, that's what the Book of Enoch said was going on. Part of the Nephilim was experimenting with plants and animals, it says. And
are
now
you familiar
we've got
with
Monsanto.
Yeah, go ahead.
I just said we have Monsanto now goofing with
yes.
our seeds and all of that.
Are you familiar with the Israel's, it's kind of a, I don't know whether you call it prophecy or what you would call it, folklore of the golem at all?
Oh,
yeah,
I have a little bit. L.A. knows a lot more about that particular aspect than I do. I'm sorry that I just got us distracted from your original question about Bigfoot and what kind of happened during this event in Watchers 10 where I met this guy who said he shot a giant.
Mm-hmm.
And the only reason I mentioned Bigfoot is that Ron Moorhead, who I mentioned earlier, who's a Bigfoot explorer, I guess you'd put it, and he's been doing this since the mid-70s,
mm-hmm.
has recordings that he's made of Bigfoot in the Sierra Nevada mountains. Now, recently, he was on Coast to Coast AM and played some of these. And I had said to him that I wanted to use that sound of the agitated Bigfoot as the voice of the monster in Watchers 10 and asked him if I could have permission to use it, which he gave me permission. I told him I would give him credit for it.
Mm-hmm.
And the only reason I did that was because the soldier that told me that he couldn't describe what this giant sounded like. He said it was high and low at the same time. And so I went through my digital audio samples that Ron had given me, and I played it for him over the phone, and I said, did it sound anything like this? And it was like, you know, this kind of a sound, really weird, you know, half human, half animal kind of sounding thing.
Mm-hmm.
And he said, it was quiet for a second, and he said, that's exactly what it sounded like.
Oh.
And so I told Ron, I said, this is a really huge clue.
Yeah.
Because these monsters, these, you know, this was a 12 to 15 foot guy that weighed 1,100 pounds that was flown out of Afghanistan in a C-130 and taken to, we believe, Wright-Patterson Air Force Base.
Yep.
Sounded like Bigfoot. But he wasn't a furry, bear-like creature. He was like a man with scarlet red hair. Now, what's interesting is the baby mummy skull that we were allowed to unwrap in Peru that was 1,900 years old had this orangish-red hair. That's the sample we're getting DNA tested.
Well, they have, there's the Native Americans, Southwest, isn't it, Larry? Where they fought the giants, and the giants were red-headed.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, absolutely. Red-haired giants.
And they were like 10, 12, 13, 14 feet tall.
And that's
Native American legends.
Yeah, a lot of the Native Americans.
You've heard L.A.'s story, haven't you, about Catalina?
No. Go ahead.
I'm sorry, Larry. I stepped on your line.
Oh, that's okay. Go ahead and tell about Catalina. Catalina, that's okay. That's very interesting.
L.A. is just totally into this stuff. I mean, he's more into the giants than I am. I actually tend to find the whole UFO thing more interesting because it's happening and you can actually film it, and I get off on the fact that this is real and the giants is an archaeological experience, but I'm totally cool with it. You know, if Ellie wants to go walk through a 7 mile wide graveyard, I'm there with my camera, you know, no problem. But, you know, and I've done that, but, anyway, he told me one day, I heard that Ralph Glidden, who exhumed, creatures in Catalina Island, there's a museum there. I said, oh, okay, cool. What? And he said, I want to go check it out. And I said, well, all right. I said, you know, before I go with you, why don't you go check it out first and see if there's anything to it? So we just save money. I mean, you know, everything we do costs money, and no one gets that.
Yes.
I mean, everybody wants us to give away everything we do for free. And it's like, okay, we have to organize a trip to Catalina. We might have to stay overnight. You know, I mean, all of a sudden it's, you know, several thousand dollars to do something like that. You have to bring equipment with you and everything else.
Mm-hmm.
So anyway, L.A. goes, and he gave them a contribution of $1,000 if they would let him look through their vault of this ancient stuff that no one's looked at in decades, and they let him do it. So he pulls out these photographs taken by Ralph Glidden, and lo and behold, there's this really large skeleton with six fingers, clearly visible. So he took a picture of it, and then there was this picture of Ralph Glidden leaning against a pickaxe over this excavation that he'd done. He was standing kind of like on a rise, and down in this pit below him was this huge skeleton, huge. Now, that was an enormous find, and that ended up on a show on the Discovery Channel and all of that. And so I said, well, if we're going to include this in Watchers 10, we probably both need to go to Catalina and I need to film all this stuff. So we go over there, and we took a boat the first time. And we get there, and we walk into the museum, and up on the wall was this picture that L.A. had found of Ralph Glidden leaning against a pickaxe over this excavation, except the giant was cut off from the picture. And L.A. and I just looked at each other with our mouths open. I said, oh, my gosh. But no one's allowed to see it. And the girl was really nice that let us in there to film and everything. And I said, where's the rest of the picture? She said, well, this was the picture they gave me to post. And she was the one doing the beautiful artwork and, you know, laying out the interior of the museum. She did a fantastic job, really beautiful work. She had never seen the rest of the picture. It wasn't shown to her. She thought that was all there was to it. So we had LA's book with him, and then we opened it up and said, here's the whole picture. And she goes, oh, wow, I've never seen that before. So I held the book up underneath their picture, and we took L.A. shot me holding the book up for it so that you can see it's the exact same image without the giant cropped off at the bottom.
Yeah.
Well,
this is an ongoing cover-up. Why people don't want us to know about this, I don't know, except it's, other than it's real. We're not supposed to know anything that's real. We're supposed to only know, you know, what the latest football scores are. I mean, that's the only thing we're supposed to do. And, you know, what's Beyonce doing and what's Madonna singing about? I mean, that's basically life the way it is, full of nonsense. So anything that is about cover-ups or truth or forbidden knowledge, we're not allowed to know those things. That's what we try to put in Watchers. And we have to be very careful because this stuff is crazy. It's hard to prove it at times. We have to be accurate and we have to be scientific in what we do. But this was a blatant covering up of the truth.
Well, there's probably several reasons why they're covering it up, and particularly the giants. And that's been going on, I think Larry would verify this, for years and years and years. And I've read that the Smithsonian, for example, is responsible for a lot of it. They just come take it, and that's the end of it. You don't ever see it again. But perhaps they don't want people believing Genesis 6, because here's the proof that Genesis 6 is accurate. If you have a 40-foot skeleton, kind of proves what Genesis said. The other part of it, though, is much more likely that it upsets the total apple cart of anthropology now. They've got the code.
Well, it does.
Yeah. Go ahead.
It totally does. I mean, anything that goes against the Darwinian theory is immediately squashed, and you risk being fired from your position. And we had a geneticist at one of the labs, and this is like maybe a year and a half ago now, that was working on a sample that we had sent him. And he was shocked at what he was coming out with it. And he wasn't doing this work for free. We have a budget that we have, that a donor set to LA just for doing DNA testing. Otherwise, we wouldn't be able to do this research because it's really expensive. And so we were paying this geneticist to do what he was doing, and his supervisor didn't want him working on it. He said, why? This is really interesting. And he says, plus, I'm doing this on my own time, so it isn't costing the lab anything. I mean, we had been paying him for his work, but he was so interested in it personally that he kept working on it anyway, just because what he was finding was astonishing. So they fired him.
Wow.
They fired this guy. Oh. And then we've had other DNA labs. I can't mention their name, where they've been really frightened at what we're sending them. because they might lose their jobs. And the ones that have been the best have been like the universities, like the university in Canada that's working on some of our samples are really excited about this material and wish they had next generation sequencing. That's only in one of the other DNA labs that we're working with has it. But they were great. I mean, and they showed us the whole process, and we're showing them at Watchers 10 how this is done and how meticulous it is. And you have to go through this clean room. You have to wear this white smock, and you stand in front of these blowers that knock off particles from your body and suck it out of a vent, and then you're allowed to go into the room where you're actually taking samples. I mean, it's really serious. This is stuff.
Yes.
This is really high-tech stuff. It's really fascinating. I love stuff like this. And, you know, that's what they're discovering is amazing. And, in fact, they had wondered if, you know, some of these skulls, like L.A. Mentions in Watchers 10 that we've heard that some of these elongated skulls have been sold and taken to Belgium. And the only thing we can figure is that they're being used in some kind of occultic ceremony. There's a lot of that going on over there.
Yeah.
Have you done any research on the crystal skulls?
I know about them, and I know that they came through Los Angeles with them a year or two ago. I didn't get to see them at the time. I don't know. I don't know what to say about them. I know what Spielberg did with Indiana Jones and the Crystal Skulls. It was an interesting film. I don't know if they hold any specific powers or if they were created by aliens or anything like that. I'd have to see them up close, but they are interesting, that's for sure.
Fascinating stuff, though, isn't it? Well, it's like Dr. Schock from Boston University when he went over and said, hey, guys, the Sphinx, that's water erosion. That's not wind erosion. And he all but got fired.
Oh, yeah, you don't dare go against the scientific community or you're just ostracized. Really, the scientific community has become like a religious cult more than anything else, I think. Because, you know, if you go against it, you're like, you know, going to get called out. You could possibly lose your position and have to fight your way to the top again.
Yeah, they don't seem
really
to want
to. Yeah.
Yeah. They don't.
I mean, we would
hear
about this stuff during the. I'm sorry, Stuart.
Yeah, go ahead. No, go ahead.
We heard about this stuff during the time of Galileo and Copernicus and all that. People seem so backwards and stupid when you hear that they were questioning the evidence that these men were coming up with at the time, that the Earth is not the center of the universe and that, you know, the sun doesn't revolve around the Earth and stuff like that. And it was the same stupidity that we're having to deal with now, which is so shocking to me that nothing has changed. And some of the rabbis in Israel, nothing has changed in their thinking over all of these years since Yeshua. And some of these guys I really dearly care for, you know, like Rabbi Glazerson. I think the world of him. His son just had another child, so now he has another grandkid, which is really great. I don't know if it's a girl or a boy yet, but. So Gladys is actually in New York today. He writes
me
all the time.
Let me ask you something, Rich. Yeah, let me ask you
something,
Richard. We're going to be running out of time soon. I wanted to ask you about this because I'd had some emails from people that listened to your show not long back. Do you have any news from Israel on any of the Temple Mount activities that's been going on or the rumors or reports from over there?
There have been a lot of people interested in it. It's very sensitive work because they don't want to start World War III. I mean, I talked to Dan about this a while back, and he said the last thing the Israeli government wants is more proof of, you know, the original temple or any of the articles. He said, because it just would start another war.
Yeah.
And,
yes.
And of course, you know, the Arabs have been trying to find stuff like that and have burrowed clear under the Temple Mount and clear over into Silwan. They found tunnels that go under Silwan, which is like a East Jerusalem town, which actually a little bit of Silwan is in the Torah Code film that I did.
Mm-hmm.
It's part Arab and part Jewish, and they're always having skirmishes. The Palestinians will come over and throw stones at cars. I mean, that's really going on all the time there. And the soldiers that ran in front of our vehicle that's in the Torah Code film were wondering what we were doing there, because that's what was going on. They were stoning cars just up ahead of the area we were driving in.
Mm-hmm. It's very volatile. That's a volatile subject.
It's very volatile. I think that there are always people trying to do this, and it's difficult, and it's has to be done in a fashion that's quiet. And, you know, then also there are internal fringe organizations operating within inside of Israel that are dissatisfied with the government and trying to start like a new Judea inside of Israel. And these are like almost like Jewish terrorists that, you know, have been caught doing things they shouldn't be doing. So, and then we've got the Rael bunch who were stalking Rabbi Glazerson and following him into a synagogue. And these people are dangerous. And, you know, so you've got organizations in Israel like the IDF and the Shin Bet and all of that whose job it is to monitor fringe organizations and keep people from, you know, killing one another.
How can they reach you, Richard? How can people get a hold of your website?
Go to pinlight.com, pinlight.com. And if you go there, you can find pretty much everything. And then if you want to see information about the Torah Code film, that's at endtodarkness.com. And some people, you know, like buy the film through a download, or other people want a hard copy, and it's also on Blu-ray. I think the Blu-ray is the best deal going, because it's high def and it's only $3 more than the standard def version. So that's what I would recommend.
Okay, Larry, how about you before we end up here out of time?
Hey, yep. People can follow me at larrywtaylor.org. That's larrywtaylor.org, and that'll work.
Okay. Hey, thank you guys.
Thank you, guys.
For coming on. That was fascinating. Fascinating
thanks,
show.
Richard.
Yep, we'll see you all later on then. Take care of yourselves.
Bye-bye.
Greatly appreciate it. Thank you.
Yep, no problem.